I will start. So I'm going to continue last time with what we did, which was start thinking about how cells estimate the concentration of something using a receptor. And remember, the basic problem we were concerned with was that we had a receptor, and we were approximating it as there was some on rate at which things bound, an off rate. And the basic game now was that the cell got to see a time series of length t, and it consisted of bound and unbound intervals like that of some length t. This is time. Time t. And the game was now to estimate the concentration from this time series. And we basically discussed two different estimators. We discussed basically the Berg and Purcell estimator, which was estimating the concentration from the average time the receptor was bound. Right? And we argued that the uncertainty, I told you that the uncertainty was basically 2 over the number of binding events during that time. And then we also touched upon the fact that there's another estimator, which is actually the one that's guaranteed to be the best estimator, at least for a one-dimensional problem. So there, for those of you who are curious, you should look up something called Stein's paradox, which is really counterintuitive and very interesting, which applies in high-dimensional estimation problems, but does not apply here. But for this problem where I have to estimate a single quantity, a concentration, you could also do maximum likelihood estimation, which just looked at unbound intervals. And you could do a factor of 2 better, which was 1 over n. Here, the uncertainty went like 1 over n, and this was the best you could do. Right? And so we started basically, I was basically showing you an argument for how you can derive this 2 over n bound. And the basic idea was, of course, that you are estimating things from this estimator, which is the average time that you're bound, n over t, which is 1 over t, 0 to t, dt prime, n of t prime. Right? And the basic idea was that you could basically estimate your error in your concentration, delta c over c bar squared, Berg-Purcell, by basically using the usual formulas. Sigma squared nt. Where sigma squared nt was the variance of this average binding time, right? And actually, let me point out that this is actually, in general, a very hard calculation to do, especially if you want to really properly treat the physics of how things diffuse here and don't diffuse here. And over the last 2, 3, 4 years, there's been a lot of controversy about exactly how you calculate this. But I will show you a heuristic, and you should talk to him, Eduardo, no. Emiliano, sorry. Wrong Italian, Argentine name. Emiliano, who actually he's an expert in this, as I found out earlier this morning. And he will tell you about all the subtleties of calculating this. But since most of us are beginners, and we're not experts, I will give you heuristic derivations of most of these things, right? And the heuristic derivation we wanted to say is that we could think about this sigma squared nt, right, as composed of 2 things. That this thing should be proportional to 1 over the number of independent measurements I make during this time t, times sigma squared n. By this, I mean the instantaneous error. And since this was a binomial process, sigma squared n, right, was just n bar, 1 minus n bar, right? Because if I toss a coin, the variance in it is just p times 1 minus p. This is just binomial theorem, right? And the harder part was the number of independent measurements. And the number of independent measurements was actually taken to be the time I'm measuring divided by 2 times the correlation time of the receptor. And this 2 is actually what you work very hard to get. Work hard. But it's intimately related to the fact I'm taking the average time and not the average unbound time. That's where all the Berg-Purcell stuff comes in. But right, the basic idea of TC, we can get that. Look, notice dN dt, I can write as k plus c, 1 minus n, minus k minus n, which is just equal to k plus c minus tau inverse c n bar. Right? These are just equations for the mean, so I'll put n bars here. And this tells us the average correlation time is just k plus c plus k minus. The average correlation time inverse is just that. Right? By definition, that's the correlation time. So you can also use this equation to solve for n bar. Right? I can set this equal to 0, solve for n bar, differentiate with respect to c, plug in all these things together, and you get that delta c over c squared, Berg-Purcell, is actually equal to 2 tau c n bar 1 minus n bar t. Right? This is just algebra, after you believe me about that 2, and that 2 basically follows exactly from this 2 here. And then I basically plug in the fact that I'm using the fact that for I'm going to assume this thing as the first approximation is diffusion limited. So k plus c is just 4 pi times sigma c naught, right? The rate at which I bind. And I can plug that in, and I can just do all these things, and I essentially get that if I plug in things in terms of these expression constants, I use k plus equals that diffusion constant, I get this expression here, that this is 2 times 4 pi sigma dc. Oh, I'm using sigma, where sigma is just a cross section. This is just like the equivalent. I realize I messed this up. So let me explain this. This is just my capacitance. Remember, everything was just a constant with a capacitance times the diffusion constant times C naught. Yeah, go ahead. That was basically saying that what is limiting the on rate of the receptor is just the fact you have to diffuse away from infinity and come hit the receptor. Right? Yes, that's the idea. The idea is that it's the current that hits the receptor. That's what the on rate is set by. The diffusive, the current, the fact that basically receptors have to come, that this, I have a bath of these things, and there is a current of them that hit this thing. Right? It's exactly the idea that your on rate is basically diffusion limited. It's the same thing we used in kinetic proofreading.
I guess I'm slightly confused with the fact that, I mean, that current calculation is a mean current calculation.
Yes.
Which is done with certain boundary condition.
Yes, and the boundary condition is that this is at infinity, and this is absorbing, and that's we're going to come back to, I mean, and the whole idea is that if this isn't absorbing, it's absorbing temporarily. We'll get to it in a second, and then it can unbind.
But it's not. Are you saying that this dynamics is much slower compared to the diffusion dynamics, and hence?
Yes. The basic idea is you're limited by the time it takes you to diffuse there. That's the implicit assumption. And you'll see why, at least that can't be entirely true, and why and that basically goes into this kind of calculation here, right? Doing this properly, that's why it's hard. You have to think about how you diffuse, how you undiffuse, and in particular, do you rebind and unbind, or do you not rebind and unbind? Because like I bind the receptor, then it diffuses, it unbinds, but then I'm locally in that neighborhood. I'm very likely to bind again. Right? And so your confusion is a very good one because it's where all the subtlety is, but that subtlety is all contained in basically this noise thing. Right now we're just using a very simple, crude approximation that I can just think about every time I bind, I've come from infinity, from the bath, and I've been diffusion limited.
And the second question I had was, so in the n-bar equation, the C, what is C?
C is just the concentration of this thing. I'm just saying the on rate is k plus c naught, right? I just come on at this rate, and I unbind at k minus, right? If I'm unbound, I bind at this rate.
Yeah, I guess I'm just slightly confused with these two things, because like one is the current coming in.
Yes.
Other is the binding with the, like...
I'm mixing up two things, right? You could, oh, I've basically lumped together two processes. I've lumped together the process where I come from from the bath and I hit the receptor with the process of actually binding. And the point is, if you want to treat those separately, we'll get to how to fix that in a second. In principle, you're right. There's two processes. One is I get in the neighborhood of the receptor. And the second is that there's some probability to bind if I'm in the receptor, if I hit the receptor. I just mix those two together. I'm just basically saying...
Like if we go actually by the calculation yesterday, you showed there is a concentration gradient and C0 is at infinity and it's zero at the receptor.
Yeah.
So if I just...
But there is a current coming in, right? There's a rate at which things hit the receptor. That's all I'm saying.
Okay.
There's a rate at which things hit the receptor. That's K plus. Well, these are good questions. It's actually very subtle. This is where all the... When I told you there's a controversy, that's what it's all about. How do you treat this properly, this diffusion, physics of diffusion properly? So let me come back here, right? And this becomes 1 minus n bar t. So now, as you pointed out, this is just something about diffusive currents. So let's think about what this is. The diffusive current to the receptor was just 4 pi sigma d c, and I apologize already, I'm dropping the c naught everywhere, but c and c naught are the same, right? Multiplied by 1 minus p times t. So let's look at this quantity in the denominator. This is just the diffusive current, right? This is the rate at which things hit the receptor. 1 minus p basically means if I take these two things together, this is the rate at which things hit the receptor when it's unoccupied. Right? And if I multiply that times t, that's precisely the number of independent samples I get. Right? This is the rate at which you hit, hit receptor, and receptor is unoccupied. So if I multiply that rate times a t, this is exactly equal to the number of binding events, the n I've been using. Right, so that's the number of independent samples I get. So this is indeed 2 over n as promised. Right? And again, all the subtlety I didn't show you, which is this factor of 2 that came in here. All right. But this is the flavor of what's going on in this thing. Right? And this is the expression you'll see in Bergen-Purcell, but not quite expressed in this idea of number of independent samples. So what are the limitations of this analysis? Well, we've already hinted at them. One, it assumes that binding events are uncorrelated. But we know that can't be the case. And the reason we know that can't be the case is because we know that from that calculation where we did, where we showed that only 0.1, if you cover 0.01% of the surface of the sphere, you get basically half the maximum current, that what's really dominating your diffusion physics is you bind, you come near the surface, and then you make many attempts to bind. Right? And so what's going to happen really is when this thing comes, it's going to unbind, it has a very high probability it rebinds the receptor. And it's going to do that over and over again. It's going to make many attempts, and it might rebind the receptor many, many times, and then eventually it'll go away. Right? B, right? Not, and this is intimately related, not all ligand binding events are diffusion limited. Right? For the same reason. Right? It could be, right, that you rebind over and over again. Or it could be that, you know, what happens is that this uncorrelated thing, the dominant process, if I think about it kind of like a particle physicist, is a particle comes here, it unbinds from the receptor, and another particle diffuses here, and this thing unbinds, and you have two correlated particles that are nearby. So I can't treat the bath as just coming from infinity. Right? And it all has to do with the fact I can bind and unbind over and over again. Right? And basically what it tells you is that this N is basically supposed to count independent samples, but these things are going to be correlated. Right? It's related to my favorite PhD problem, which is the Kondo effect. That's literally how the Kondo effect happens with spin flips. Where I spent my whole PhD thinking. That has no intuition for anyone except for me, but I feel obligated to say it after spending 6 years of my life thinking about that problem. All right. So it turns out, after a lot of work, you can actually fix this fairly. It turns out, after a lot of work, at least some set of people in the community think this problem can be fixed very easily with another effective theory. And the effective theory is basically this intuition, right? Let me draw what's really going on, right? So imagine I actually have a lot of binding and unbinding events. Well, then I'm going to get something like this. This is going to bind, this is going to unbind, this is going to bind, this is going to... Okay, let me draw it on a different graph, because it'll be better. So what am I really saying? I'm saying there's high probability that when you unbind, you rebind the receptor again, right? And so you can really think of this as something where I have some clustered set of bindings go away, and I have another cluster set of bindings. Maybe I have two, maybe I have one, but I have some clustered set of bindings like this, right? So I have a bunch of stuff where things cluster. But it's clear that I should be able to just replace some picture like this with a coarse-grained picture where I have a different effective binding rate and a different effective unbinding rate. Because this thing basically looks like I'm going to treat all these binding and unbinding things as one event. And that makes sense from sampling theory too, because they're just so highly correlated, I can treat them as one sample. Right? And so it turns out you can actually do that. Right? And so what you can do is you can actually, the same expression basically goes through in a more careful analysis, but now you have a K plus effective, right? So let me rewrite these things. Let me rewrite you a differential equation.
Oh dear. The thing is, when we are just considering the right particles, we are totally forgot about the possibility of some other stuff which coming and basically binding to the same thing, which is not like, you know, in case of TCR, they used to consider this particle D, which could also bind.
Yeah. So
but they used to bind for a much shorter time.
Yeah. So we're not doing that. We're doing one particle.
Yeah. So, but the thing is, like, if you can basically take those, you know, things which are very short lived, binding unbinding events. So what is the consequence in case where there are these lot of these like a particle like D which binds and unbinds more frequently, but they also undergo the same process? So will those things also be considered as, you know, correlated?
So you're going to get an effective on rate for C, uh-huh, and different effective on rate for D.
Okay.
Different effective on rate for C. I mean, the point is that if this picture is basically what's happening, which is really what's happening, then it's clear I can just treat lots of places where things bind, and unbind over until they diffuse away as effectively one sample. And that's the same thing as saying I have a different on rate and a different off rate. Right? Because I have to renormalize this thing in a geometric series that basically sums what's the probability I rebind once, or the probability I rebind twice, or I rebind three times, right? It's basically just a summing of a series, right? For the particle physicists, is literally resumming of a series, right? Where you just basically, but the picture basically tells you everything. That's what you're going to do, right? And so before I do that, let me say this. So like a more careful treatment of this problem, if I had separated out the diffusion from the binding, would be something like this, right? I would say that dN dt is kA. C at the position of the receptor as a function of time t, 1 minus n of t minus k, let me call it d nt times dc dx dt dt equals d del squared cxt minus delta x minus x naught dn dt. Right? Which is basically saying I treat the diffusion, and if I'm at this point cx naught, I can bind, and this thing can diffuse, and it can, if it undiffuses, then I get a change in the concentration if it binds or unbinds. Right? But the important point is now I've separated out these constants Ka and Kd from the diffusion. But it basically turns into the problem we'd written down before. If you do this properly by basically saying I treat these binding and unbinding events together, right? It turns out you can define an effective K plus and K minus which is just basically equal to Ka, Kd, Ka plus Kd, where Kd is our old friend, the diffusive, our old diffusive flux. Let me not write K capital D, and let me make sure. And K minus is Kd, capital Kd, Ka plus Kd. And basically, you should think of this kind of ratio here as basically looking at the probability that when I bind, what's the probability I rebind compared to the probability that I diffuse away? Right? Because the ratio of Kd over Ka basically tells you the probability that I rebind if I'm at the position of the receptor, what's the probability I rebind or the probability I diffuse away? Right? And this is essentially really a geometric series, right? I can think of this as 1 over 1 plus Kd over Ka, which is really 1 minus Kd over Ka plus, anyway, it doesn't matter. You can resum this series, and it really comes from the fact, the reason you have this form is because you're really saying, what if I rebind once? What if I rebind twice? What if I rebind three times? And you basically can, so many people, I should add, think that you can I am in this camp. I think the basic problem is this is basically the same. All the things come back, and you can just renormalize the effective on and off rate. And so that diffusion binding and unbinding can be taken into account in this thing. And the person who I think figured this out, though, Emiliano disagrees with me, is Peter Ten Wolde's group. They have a paper in Biophysical Journal last year that I really think is superb. All right. Yeah, go ahead.
That equation, the C equation, we are assuming that the dn by dt is like actually something significant, meaning, and that equation has a noise term. So,
yeah, you have to treat the noise properly. That all goes, so you really have to use these equations to calculate the variance of the thing we said, the average receptor occupancy, and that's why it's a non-trivial problem and hard.
What I'm wondering is, like, in an actual situation, uh-huh. I mean, is it true that the concentration dynamics will actually change because of the receptor binding and unbinding?
Yes. I mean, it's really that, really, the picture you should have is this red picture.
That's true. But, I mean, that equation is a mean equation anyway for the C.
Yeah, but you can put the noise in. I mean, you can treat it. I mean, the C, yes. Yeah, yeah, so that's what all the controversy is about.
That term is greater than the, like, more, much more significant than the noise term in the C equation.
I don't know what you mean, but maybe we can talk about it. I mean, it's subtle. All I can tell you is these problems are subtle, and they're hard to even formulate, because you're making some stuff point functions, other things you're not. What part of the correlation do I have to take into account? What do I have to take into account in the physics of diffusion? That's what all the controversy is about. But spiritually, it seems like these kind of renormalizations agree really well with particle, you know, with like really particle level diffusion simulations, is what I can tell you. Right? You're getting to the heart of why this is a hard problem if you want to solve it more than heuristically. Right? But the basic Berg-Purcell idea, again, is that I time average, I count the number of samples, and then again, this is just this basic sampling theory, which is that I should count the number of independent samples, and so I can treat these kind of correlated binding and unbinding events as one thing. And that basically effectively goes into renormalizing my on and off rates. Right? That's what you were supposed to take away from these things. All right. How much time do I have? 1 minute and 4 seconds. Oh, no, 1 hour and 4 minutes. That's much better. For me, for you, you have to suffer more, so it's okay. Okay. All right. Now let me tell you briefly about this maximum likelihood estimation as promised, right? Remember, we said maximum likelihood estimation did better because all the information is contained in the unbound intervals about the concentration and none of it in the bound intervals. And so we should think about just looking at the unbound intervals. So how do we get that in a principled way? Well, the way we get that in a principled way is by doing maximum likelihood estimation. And so the way maximum likelihood estimation says is, let me take a time series, right? And I can define a time series by basically defining, you know, a series of binding event where I bind and a series of unbinding events. So let me call this T1 plus. This is T1 minus. This is T2 plus. This is T2 minus. And so on and so on, right? A time series is basically given by a set of times that define the time I bind on and the time I bind off. And so now I can ask you, given a concentration, what's the probability of seeing a T plus, T minus, given a concentration? Right? That's the likelihood of seeing that time series given I had a concentration C, right? And here's the exercise. If I call my on rate again K plus and my off rate K minus, here's the exercise, and it's a fairly straightforward one. Show that P, T plus, T minus, C is just equal to e to the k minus TB, e to the minus K plus C, TU, K minus to the N, K plus C to the N. And I shouldn't say equal to, I mean proportional to. Right? Where TB is the total time I'm bound. And TU is the total time I'm unbound. And in considering this thing, I'm assuming N, the number of binding events, is large, so I can ignore the difference between, you know, I can have one more binding event than unbinding event, but I ignore that difference. Right? So this is just saying, I have a generative model. I know I bind at K plus C, I unbind at K minus, just tell me what the probability of seeing a given time series is. Right? And here we've assumed N is much, much larger than 1. So what does maximum likelihood estimation say? Well, maximum likelihood estimation says my best estimator for C, right, is the thing that maximizes the probability of my observations. So my observations now are T plus and T minus. And maximum likelihood estimation says maximize the probability of these observations. So you can do dp dc, it's a straightforward exercise, equals minus k plus tu p plus n cml, right? Dp n p equals 0. And so this implies that the maximum likelihood estimator for C is just, oh, sorry, I meant to use capital N, is n divided by k plus TU. All right? So it basically, again, only depends on what I would call the average unbound interval, which is TU divided by N, which is what we promised you. right? And it's physically clear why. Right? The best you're gonna do is if I just pay attention to the unbound intervals. I don't care about the bound intervals at all. And again, you can work through all these things. You can calculate the error bars in your maximum likelihood estimator. Using something called the Kramer-Rao bound, which I don't have time to go into. It's called the Kramer-Rao bound. And it basically says, take the second derivative of the log of the log likelihood, and that gives you some error bars, and you can show that this is 1 over n. Right? Not going to go into it. But it's something called the Kramer-Rao bound. It's pretty standard stuff. It has a Wikipedia page. You can look through how it works. But the basic idea is that if I look at the log likelihood is going to be peaked at some point, right? The maximum likelihood is where the log of the likelihood is peaked. And look at the width, the Gaussian width around that peak, and that's going to give me my error bars. All right. So that is essentially what I wanted to tell you about how to estimate these things, right? But notice we made no reference in everything we did so far to how we would actually compute this. How would a cell actually do maximum likelihood estimation? How would a cell actually make a Bergen per cell estimate? Right? What is the energetic cost of doing all these stuff? Should there be an energetic cost? Right? So first, let us try to argue that there should be an energetic cost for doing this. Right? Why should there be an energetic cost? What's a general argument? We used it for There's two general lines of argumentation that tell you that you have to consume energy.
Because you're getting information out of it. So, yeah.
I don't know. I mean, maybe. How about something more specific?
Because you have more intermediates in your reaction, maybe? The sensing?
No, more abstract. Let's try to think through. What was the most abstract thing we said about the kinetic proofreading of why you needed to consume energy? Time reversal symmetry is breaking. Are we breaking time reversal symmetry here? Well, let's think about it, right? The receptor binding unbinding kinetics actually does satisfy detail balance. That's not where you're going to break time reversal symmetry. So at the level of the receptor, at least as the way it's written down, there's no time reversal symmetry being broken. But what about the downstream network that computes this average? Are you averaging for some time t? Right? Here, it's more subtle to see that time reversal symmetry is broken, but it is. But the lambda argument is more intuitive here. If I'm going to average for some time t, then I have to have a memory. Right? Because I have to have a memory that stores what's going on for time t. And if I want to redo this over and over and over again, right? I don't want to just estimate it once. I want to have a circuit that I can reuse. Then I know I'm going to have to erase this memory. Right? Because I want the estimate in this time average. Then I use that memory to estimate in the next time average. And I have a running average. Right? So I'm continuously erasing my memory. And Landauer told us that if we're erasing memory, then we have to consume energy, right? So on general grounds, because I'm erasing memory and because I'm breaking time reversal symmetry, you can imagine that that you can't do this without consuming energy. But again, we have to go back to the old idea that if we want to make these things more concrete, we have to think about the biophysical and biochemical correlates of this. So we have to think about a genetic network that can compute the Bergen per cell estimator. Right? So we're going to go from this abstract thing to a particular network. And we're going to implement this Bergen per cell estimator, and then I'm going to show you how you could also implement a maximum likelihood estimator by considering non-equilibrium receptors. But the rest of the talk is basically going to be about how can we realize this in a real biochemical circuit, because once we have the physical, biophysical, biochemical correlates, then we can start asking about physics questions. All right, so let's do that for the remaining hour. And I will show you how very naturally the same ideas that we had about kinetic proofreading basically follow trivially over to this example. Maybe a little bit non-trivially, but largely trivially. All right? So now we're going to try to think about how would you actually compute this thing. So let me postpone thinking about maximum likelihood estimation till after I go through this Bergen Purcell calculation. Let's go through the Bergen-Purcell calculation, right? Well, I'm just going to tell you the answer, right? So imagine I want to implement Bergen-Purcell. It turns out you can implement Bergen-Purcell with one of the classic motifs of bacterial signaling, which is a two-component system. And so the basic idea is that I have a receptor, and now I'm going to draw the receptor slightly differently. And again, the receptor can be in two states. That. And it switches between these conformations basically the same way we talked about it before, right? And for various notational reasons, so I wouldn't get confused, I am using K4 for the on rate and K4 for the off rate. But the basic idea is that there's a rate that depends on the concentration, right? K4 plus C. I can bind, and when I'm bound, I change the conformation of my receptor, right? And I can unbind, right? And now I have to now tell you, convey the information of whether I'm bound or unbound to something downstream, right? To my memory device, because my memory device wants to average my occupancy state. And so the way I do that is I basically have a downstream protein that I can put in two states, X star, right? And what happens is that if I'm in this state, I phosphorylate this protein at some state I'll call K2 on. So let me call this the on state. Let me call this the off state. And if I'm in the off state, I phosphorylate this protein at a different rate, which let me call K2 off. All right? So all I'm doing is saying I have a downstream protein, and it basically is going to record the state of these of my receptor. And the way it records the state is basically if I'm in the on state, let's say K2 on is much bigger than K2 off, I get much more X star. But if I'm in the off state, you know, I make much less of this X star. The other thing I need to have is a memory, right? I need to have a time that I average over. So what in this thing is going to set the time that I average over? So my information about the state of the receptor is in X star. What's the physical correlate of my averaging time? Anyone have any ideas? Right? This X star, what I'm going to do is I'm going to make it degrade at some time, turn back into X at some state. And it's clear that K1, the rate at which I make this X star turn back into X, basically sets the time on which I average. Because if I instantaneously turn X star back into X, I'm going to have no memory of what happened before me. And in fact, the Bergen-Purcell time, right, turns out that T, the time I average, you can show, and I'll show you in a second, is exactly equal to 2 times K1 inverse. Right? So it's basically the lifetime, 2 times the lifetime of this protein X star. Right? And the other thing, notice, is that this delta K2, which is K2, for some reason, off minus K2 on, it's not really important, right? The difference between the on rate and the off rate basically tells me about the quality of my sample. If these two things are exactly the same, I can't tell the difference between the on and off state. The more different I make K2 on from K2 off, the higher quality my sample is. Right? But now let's think about this. The more I make this difference, so the bigger I make this K2 on, the better the quality of my sample, and the more I'm going to go through this futile cycle. Right? So we're already getting hints that if I want to learn stuff, I better have more energy being consumed. Right? So you can basically work through this network, right? You can write down a very simple set of equations that basically describe this thing, right? The probability of being on basically goes like K4 plus 1 minus P on minus K4 minus P on. And I like to, you can basically write some Langevin equations, or you could write the appropriate master equations. I'll just write Langevin equations here. Right here, n is the number of x stars I have, and I basically write down stupid two equations, the usual two equations you would expect. And I can basically calculate both the mean number of proteins I'll have and the variance in the number of proteins I'll have, and which I'll call sigma squared n. And then using the same trick as before, I can basically calculate my estimation, my estimate, by basically saying it's equal to C dn bar dc minus 2 sigma squared n, right? So this is a straightforward exercise in stochastic processes. You can even solve the master equation exactly if you don't want to do it in second order. But it's a straightforward process in something I don't have time to teach you. If I had another lecture, I would have gone through this. Gone through this derivation, but it's pretty much straightforward stochastic process stuff, right? And you can solve for sigma squared n, you can solve for n bar, and you can calculate your best estimate of delta c bar, right? And you get that the answer is that it's n bar over n bar minus k2 off over k1 over p bar off squared plus 2 over the number of binding intervals times 1 minus k1 over k4 plus k4 minus plus k1. It's really not that important. So you can just go through and calculate it. And you get two terms. And this, I forgot a squared here. That's a squared on the bottom. You get a term that scales like 1 over n bar, 1 over n bar. And you have another term that in the limit where my averaging time, k1, the time I average over, is much faster than k4 plus and k4 minus. So I'm really time averaging many, many events. Basically, goes like 2 over n. Okay? So let me just rewrite that somewhere where people can see it in the middle of the board. Right? So the point is you can calculate this thing using this very straightforward thing for this network, and you get your estimation has two terms. A first term that's proportional to 1 over n bar, where this is the number of x star on average you have at steady state, plus another term that is basically the Berg over Purcell term, 1 plus some small stuff. If I average long enough. And so if I use a lot of proteins, I can basically suppress this thing as small as I want. And this is basically, remember we started this lecture, we were saying the Bergen per cell is the fundamental limit, but I can have bias due to the fact that I have a noisy machine. And so this is basically my thing that says I have a noisy machine, and my machine becomes less and less noisy the more proteins I make. Right? So, and the more proteins I make means the more energy I consume. Right? But I can kill this term, we're not going to think about it, and I basically have something that estimates, that gives me the Bergen per cell estimator. Right? And it's basically, you know, on some level, you can basically, it's useful to think of this in computational terms. Basically, the whole point is the memory, right, is the number of X star writing to memory. Is phosphorylation, and erasing memory is dephosphorylation. All right. So here is the simplest biochemical. Yeah, you have a question, Matt?
So can you do order of magnitude for how much E. coli, for example, actually spends on this?
Oh, it doesn't spend anything on it. Doesn't that total to spends what, like energy wise?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, these are negligible costs. You can basically the best estimate I know is from Ron Milo, and he estimates. I think Sanjay was at this meeting where this happened, right? We had this conversation, and it was something like Ron Milo's estimate. He wrote a book called Bio Numbers, so he's going to be the best we're going to do. His estimate was 15 to 20% of your energy budget is spent on just all post-translational modifications. This would be a tiny version of it.
I guess 20% sounds quite significant, but
yeah, but that's over all things. And this one particular receptor is not going to do anything. That's all post-translational modifications.
But you don't think all post-translational modifications should be thought of as maybe not for this receptor, but things like this?
Oh, I think they're basically for things like that. They're basically for erasing things and for things where we have to break time reversal symmetry. For example, one of the things I was asking Tom was like when he excises, how do you break the difference between the thing that excises in and excises out? And I think there has to be some phosphorylation in these things. I mean, once you start thinking about time reversal symmetry, you see that there's lots of processes where there must be energy consumed. And so I think they are mostly for processes like this. I think there's a reason in eukaryotes, there's a reason everything signals with phosphor relays and does not signal transcriptionally. And it's because you have to erase in order to reuse these signaling networks. And erasing, when you do it transcriptionally, means making a protein and degrading it, which is much more expensive than basically going through ATP. But this is all speculation. Right? So now we can start thinking about energy. Right? So how can we think about the energy that has to be consumed by something like this? And the basic idea is that when do you consume energy? Well, it's clear when you consume energy. You consume energy when you go from X to X star and come back to X. Right? Every time there's a futile cycle. Right? And so the interesting thing about this kind of process is that you can think of it basically as a Markov process, right? If I think about the state space of this network, it basically has a state space that looks like this. Off, on, the receptor can be in one of two states, off and on, and the number of X stars can basically be 0, 1, 2, 3, like that, 0, 1, 2, 3, so on and so on. And I can, of course, switch back and forth between these things. Right? You basically, this basically, I go forward at some rate K2 on here, oh, K2 off here. I degrade at K1, I degrade at K1. Here I go on some rate K2 on, and these are basically set by K4. I basically, this is all the, this describes the state space of my system completely. Now, it looks a lot like the kinetic proofreading diagrams I was drawing, right? Where we were talking about, those were chains, this just happens to be a ladder. And now I can again ask, if I break detail balance, right? So if I say that the probability of going forward and backwards is not the same, if any of these links is driven, then I know I must be consuming energy. Equally likely, I can say, if this is a Markov process, if I set up probability currents, right? If I set up loops like these are basically futile cycles, then I know I must also be consuming energy. Right? This is the same thing we were saying with kinetic proofreading. If I drive this system, so I break detail balance in this space, or equivalently, if I set up non-trivial current probability currents in these loops, then I must be consuming energy. How much energy are you consuming? Well, it turns out, right? You remember what we said, the energy that's consumed across a given link, right? Is basically dependent, let me call the state I'm starting off at sigma. Let me call the state that I'm going to sigma prime. Right? The energy that I'm going to consume is basically proportional to the bias between going to sigma prime versus the rate at which I go from sigma prime to sigma. Right? So this is basically, this k sigma prime is the rate at which I go from state sigma to sigma prime. And this k sigma prime to sigma is the rate at which I go back from sigma prime to sigma. Right? It's basically really measures locally how biased you are. The same thing we were saying in kinetic proofreading. And so the log of this is basically like my change in free energy when I go across that link. It's how much energy I had to put to bias this thing. If I want to know the total energy that's consumed, I better multiply that times basically the current across, the net current across this thing. Right? In detail balance, you don't consume any energy because I get some delta F here. But I give that delta F back, but I'm guaranteed that in detail balance, how much I go here equals how much I come back here. So on average, I'm not going to consume any energy. It's only if I drive this thing, so there's a net current, some of this is bigger than that, the direction this way is bigger than the direction that way, I'm going to get this stuff. And so you can write down basically what are these famous entropy production formulas that were derived by Leibowitz and Spohn and Derrida, which basically says, for any Markov process, the entropy production rate basically is given by, if I sum over all things that are related by a link, it's basically P sigma K sigma prime. Let me rewrite this better. These formulas look very mysterious, but they have very intuitive definitions. That goes, like this. So what is this saying? It's saying this is basically the difference in free energy when I go from sigma to sigma prime. And this is the current across, net current across that link. So I have some net current across this link. Boom. And I have some energy, delta F, that I drop across this thing. The only way I'm going to get a net current is if somehow I have coupled this to an energy source. Somewhere in the system, I've coupled it to an energy source. Otherwise, I'm in detail balance, and I'm never going to get a net current, and the entropy production is zero. And this is essentially Ohm's law, right? It says it's P equals IV. I'm just doing P equals IV. This is I, this is the current. This is V, delta F. It's literally Ohm's law across every link. Right? And this is the very famous Derrida and Leibowitz results on Markov processes. right? But now this is nice because this was a particular case, but you give me any biochemical network, if I can calculate, I draw you its state space, I tell you the kinetics of it, if I can calculate the steady state probability, I can tell you exactly what how much energy it's consuming. Right? But it's the same intuition as kinetic proofreading. If I want to bias this thing, I better be consuming energy. How much energy do I consume? The difference in free energy drop across the two things, which is basically the log of the forward versus the backward rates. All right? And so what we did is we calculated this thing, and you can basically now calculate, you know, there's a natural, a control parameter, which is delta K2, which is basically how the quality of my sample. And as you ramp up delta K2, right, on one plot, you can basically plot power consumption. On the other plot, you can plot uncertainty. And you can basically show that as the power consumption goes to zero, right, power, your uncertainty always diverges. And using these kind of formulas, you can show that if and only if you consume power, can you get a non-zero uncertainty about things. Okay. And so I would argue that, again, just like kinetic proofreading, by taking seriously, and Landauer, by taking seriously the biophysical correlate of the information, you can basically show that these things require energy to compute. Right? So that would be the claim. We did it for a particular network, but you can basically convince yourself from these arguments that you have to erase memory, and that you have to break time reversal symmetry. Time reversal symmetry in the language of Markov processes is the same thing as saying I set up a current in a given direction. Right? Because once I have a loop, if I run things backwards, they go around in a loop in the opposite way. So the movie doesn't look the same, forward and backwards. And so this is basically this classic calculation of Berg and Purcell from a thermodynamic point of view. And it basically tells you what you know from Landauer already, but it's kind of rewarding to see it. And what's more interesting is that there's a very simple interpretation of energy consumption. And it's clear that it's very general. You give me a chemical process, I can tell you exactly how much energy it's consuming. And this is why I think there's hope, lots of us think there's hope, for proving general theorems about stuff. And there's a lot of results that have popped out in StatMech, mostly out of France, honestly. And Derrida's always one step removed from every result, or directly involved. About these things, and it's intimately related for those of you who are stat physicists to large deviation theory, which is really interesting. Anyway, there's a lot of technical, beautiful stuff we can get off on if you get off on that kind of stuff. I like to read that stuff in privately and never do a public calculation with it because I feel very intimidated. So that's my bedtime reading these crazy StatMech papers that are very beautiful, but very hard to understand. All right? So what I want you to take away is that basically the intuition is the same as we had for kinetic proofreading. Right? You consume energy to drive stuff. But there's this added twist that here it's easier to think about you're consuming energy to erase memory instead of time reversal symmetry breaking, because the time reversal symmetry breaking is hidden in the state space of these Markov processes, the fact that you're setting up probability currents here. But basically, probability currents are futile cycles. Right? I start at this thing, I go here, I have to consume energy, but I end up the same place I started. All right, for the last 30 minutes, now let me tell you about how you can consume energy, even more energy, and basically go from doing Berg and Purcell estimation to basically maximum likelihood. So what I'll show you is a family of non-equilibrium receptors that allow you to interpolate between the Berg and Purcell limit and the maximum likelihood estimation limit. And then I'm hoping I will have 10 minutes down, and I will write down to you some general, my general ideas. I will spend the last 10 minutes telling you my general ideas of what I think energy is useful for in biology. All right. So this was for Berg and Purcell, but how do I implement maximum likelihood estimation? So remember, the whole point of maximum likelihood estimation was that I wanted to make my bound intervals as deterministic as possible. Right? So imagine what's going on here. How are my bound intervals in Berg and Purcell set? Well, my bound intervals are basically, so if I call this unbound, right, I'm going to call my unbound interval 0, always, and I call my bound interval 1. Well, my bound intervals always have Poisson noise, right? Because basically it's just a one-step process. But now imagine, instead of a one-step process, my bound intervals basically walked. I forced my things to walk, keep on going like this, through L steps before coming back. Right? So this is unbound. And when I'm unbound, and then here I'm bound, and I signal. Right? So I'm basically going to call these the not signaling state, and I'm going to call this the signaling state. And now imagine my signaling state, instead of being one step, the way I come back from my signaling state is I have actually L signaling states. And what I do is I deterministically walk through these L signaling states. We'll talk about whether it's biophysically, right? This is not biophysically plausible because I can't just go in one direction, right? But if my lifetime of my signaling state here was tau, I could think about what the lifetime here is. Well, on average, it's L times tau, right? If I put L steps together. But more importantly, how does my coefficient of variation go? How does my variance over the mean squared go if I have L steps that I walk through? Right? How does it compare? What? Yeah, it's reduced by a factor of 1 over L. Right? If I force something, right? If I have this is the same kinetic proofreading argument, right? If this was a lifetime tau, and then I basically could walk my thing to L steps, then I'd reduce my variation by 1 over L. Right? So it's clear that if I could make an infinitely long chain, where I deterministically walk through this chain, my estimator now, right? It turns out you can show very easily that your estimator for an arbitrary thing basically goes like 1 over the number of binding events, which we know it has to be, but the coefficient basically is proportional to the variation of my signaling bound interval times the mean squared. Right? It's basically saying exactly what we know in words, which is that the best you can do is 1 when I'm completely deterministic. And when I'm a Poisson process, this is also 1. So I get 2. Right? It's basically saying my uncertainty factor comes from the fact that my binding intervals are stochastic. And if I make them less stochastic, I make them better. And so I can try to make them less and less stochastic by basically walking through them through this L thing, but I know this is not thermodynamically feasible, of course. Right? When I always have a backward rate, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to couple this to some energy source to drive it this way. Right? So I couple to a driving source. I drive this thing through L steps, basically, and I basically reduce my variance by 1 over L. All right, that's the basic idea. But in this case, doing something quantitatively gives you something really interesting. All right? So it turns out, you can ask, what's the correction to this deterministic thing? And there's some surprises that we still don't really understand. But it's really actually super interesting to me. So the first thing you can do is you can do asymptotics. Right? You can say for large L, what does this thing look like? Well, this thing goes like 1 plus 1 over L, which is what you'd get for the deterministic case, plus a correction that goes like e to the minus t times the power, this is the power consumed, or the entropy production rate, power, divided by the length times the number of samples, number of binding events. All right? And you can do deterministics. You can actually do numerical simulations where you try to find optimums, and you get data collapses. And what we find is your estimator, in terms of energy, seems to depend, how good your estimator is, seems to depend only on the energy consumed per sample. Right? That's what this is saying. This is the total energy consumed, and that's divided by the number of samples. So your optimal, the best you can do, seems to be just set by the amount of energy you consume per sample, independent of all the other details. So we've done a lot of numerical Monte Carlos to try to check this. And you'll see some data collapses. This is the asymptotic result, but it's also true numerically throughout the whole range. And you can see some data collapses in our PRL paper we just put out a year ago. Right? And whenever we numerically have checked stuff the best we can with other topologies, this seems to be what's true. So somehow, it seems like your ability to do statistics is limited by how much energy you're consuming per sample, for reasons we don't understand at all. Right? But the basic idea of why you'd want to consume energy in this thing is very, very, is kind of interesting. So again, it's the same idea as kinetic proofreading. Drive this thing deterministically, and you can reduce the variance of something. Right? Here, we're consuming energy to reduce variability. Actually, the prototypical example of this you guys should read is actually related to what Tom was talking about today, which is that when you detect photons, how do you detect a single photon? Right? You have to amplify that into an electrical signal. Right? So you have to have a rod. It has a single rhodopsin molecule, which detects a photon. And that single photon has to be amplified into a macroscopic electrical signal. And you can, and it turns out the noise in the current downstream of that, in that single neuron, has very low signal-to-noise ratio. And it turns out rhodopsin actually does this funny thing where it uses the energy from the photon to go into a high-energy state, and it walks its way deterministically down an L-step cascade to reduce the variability of the signaling time. So this is, I think, explained in Bill's book. Is it explained in Bill's book? I don't remember. Okay. It might be in Bill Bialik's book, new book on searching for biophysical principles. I learned this all from Anirvan Sengupta, who has a beautiful paper with Boris Schreiman on this called Engineering Aspects of Enzymatic Cascades, which is a biophysical journal paper from the year 2000, which is, to me, one of the best papers I've read. Yeah. Go ahead, Ben.
I don't quite understand what you mean. That
it only depends. So it looks to me like it depends on both L and the energy. And
yeah, we don't know what this L is doing. I mean, we can just tell you that like it does depend on L, but this, in every numerical thing we come in, the entropy production rate only comes in through these. The way the entropy production rate always comes in is through this combination. T times the power entropy production rate divided by N. That's all I can tell you. It's basically the power consumed divided by the sampling rate is another way of saying it. You can data collapse it, right? Because you can measure these things separately, and you can say, can I collapse it on this thing?
I see. You're saying there's an extra term that comes because you're adding steps, and any additional step will add noise.
Yeah.
But the more energy you use, the smaller that.
Yeah. Noise. Yeah. Exactly. For a fixed L, this is what you do. All right. So, again, here, basically, is an example of where you're using energy to increase the fidelity of your information transmission. And the trick you're using here is to reduce variability. One, you are using a time delay to increase discrimination. Here, you're reducing variability. So that raises the question, what can energy be used for by cells? All right? So we sat around, because we wrote this review. I agreed to write some review, and then it was due in 3 weeks, and all three of us hadn't written anything, so I had to sit there for 3 weeks and brainstorm some ideas. And so I thought I'd write about my personal feelings on what energy is good for, right? So after brainstorming all the examples in my head, I basically thought, there's five basic purposes of energy. There's probably more, but these are five big ones I could think of in all my canonical examples. One was increasing specificity. And of course, the canonical example of this is the kinetic proofreading that we talked about. The second, give me a second. I'm gonna drink some more water. I have to stop screaming when I lecture, but this is an old habit by now. Ugh, and stop making messes. The second major thing is manipulating dynamics. Right? So one of the things we learn, what do I mean by that? Well, in equilibrium, the steady state occupation of anything is intimately related to the kinetics. You can't decouple the two. The probability I occupy a state is entirely set by the kinetics. But once I start consuming energy, I can decouple how often I occupy a state from the kinetics, right? And this is generically true. In condensed matter theory, this is basically why you need an extra, this is what the Keldysh contour is about. This is what, you know, generically you can think about. And the nice example of this is actually a series of beautiful experiments on something in synthetic biology. So this has actually been exploited in synthetic biology recently in a beautiful, you know, kind of hard to digest, but I'll try to give you the flavor of what they do, but they actually built this thing to build what they call kinetic insulators, right? So if you look up this word on Google, it will pop up, kinetic insulators, and this is something in synthetic biology, so let me try to explain to you what the idea of a kinetic insulator is, all right? And this goes back to an old idea in engineering, which goes under the name of retroactivity. So, what is retroactivity? It basically means that if I have some circuit, some engineering thing, and I start coupling it to some outputs, merely the fact that I've coupled it to another output could change the behavior of the circuit itself, right? And we kind of know that. Like if you take some power source and you put too much power in it, it drains things. Lights start flickering, bad things start happening, right? And you don't want to do that if you're an engineer. You want to make circuits that are somehow don't get changed when I couple them to something. So the classic example that these guys were thinking about was that imagine I have some regulation, I have some time-dependent production, or some time-dependent creation of some intermediary Z. And what it can do, what I want to do now is I want to use this Z, which I can think of as a transcription factor, to regulate a bunch of promoters. Right? So I want to use it to regulate a bunch of genes. Now, if I start putting too many promoters in here, right? If I wanted to regulate lots and lots of genes and have lots of promoters, what's going to happen is this Z is going to be sequestered by these promoters. And so it's going to change the dynamics of the circuit itself. And so the basic idea of kinetic insulation was that if I instead couple Z to a futile cycle, a really fast futile cycle, that basically goes from X to X star in my language, and let X star basically regulate these promoters, then the time scale mismatch, and let's assume that this happens on a really fast time scale compared to everything here, so I'm just burning through energy to change the kinetic, create a kinetic mismatch, I can basically insulate this circuit from what's going on. I'm running out of time, so I won't write down any equations, but you can take my word for it that there's a simple way of doing it. If you read the original papers, it's almost incomprehensible. In our review, we have a two equation version of this that I think accurately captures what they're saying, but I'm still not 100% sure, even after spending weeks reading those papers. Right? But the basic idea is that you create kinetic mismatches. So the third general thing you can do with energy is reduce variability. And that's what we were using this to in this maximum likelihood example. And the other classic example is rhodopsin. So if you look at variability, shut off of rhodopsin, right? How the rhodopsin molecule shuts off. All right, the fourth general thing that I think you can use energy for is the obvious thing, which is amplifying signals. And by amplifying signals, I really mean number gain. Which means that I have one molecule of something, and it makes 100 molecules of something downstream. And the canonical example of this is, of course, the push-pull amplifier. So imagine that I have something that gets activated, and it's an enzyme that catalyzes this reaction X to X star. Then from a single molecule of enzyme, I can make hundreds of molecules of X star. But I could not do that in equilibrium. In equilibrium binding, one molecule of X can bind one molecule of E, and that's it. So at most, you can make one downstream output for one downstream molecule for one upstream molecule. And people often say cooperativity gives you amplification, but that's not true. It gives you logarithmic sensitivity. If I think about cooperativity, I have N molecules binding an output. Actually, my signal goes down by 1 over N. Anyway, that's a technical point for those who are interested. I would say number gain is very different from what's usually called logarithmic gain, which basically measures change in the log of the output concentration from the log of the input concentration. This is not what I mean. I mean number gain. How many molecules of output do you make from each molecule of input? All right. And the final thing that I think energy is useful for, at least that we could come up with, is for erasing memory. Erasing memory or resetting systems. Resetting systems slash breaking the arrow of time. Right? Which all I think are the same thing. in various contexts. Right? And so, you know, the interesting thing about, if you think about this over and over again, is that there's certain things that keep popping up. If you want to do this, you basically make two kinds of things. You make lots of futile cycles and you couple them together. This is the MAP kinase cascade. This is the gain amplifier. This is basically things that manipulate kinetics. And the other thing that's really you want to do is you want to make long chains, right? So all this reducing variability, kinetic proofreading was basically about chains, right? And so what if you go through these biochemical networks, you basically see these motifs where you're basically making what seems like a bunch of useless phosphorylations. Like, why would I want to phosphorylate things 17 times, you know? Some of these tyrosine, kinesine receptors have hundreds of phosphorylation sites. And you have things that go through bunches of futile cycles. So if you look at a real signaling network, you'll see that it's just all futile cycles and all redundant phosphorylations, it seems, naively. And I think if we start thinking about things through these kind of basic lens of these five basic properties, these things start making a lot more sense. At least they started making a lot more sense to me. I'm not even saying it's exhaustive, but it's also useful to think about it this way if I want to start forward engineering circuits. So if I want to forward engineering circuits, I should think about if I want to do any of these things. And if I want to do any of these things, I better build in energy sources into these things. And the energy sources I want to build in are not protein production and degradation, because that's really, really expensive. I want to do post-translational modifications. And my suspicion is that in the level of gene regulation, a lot of the role of chromatin and chromatin marks is to do these kind of things. In the level of signal, I think as far as chromatin is concerned, what it offers you is a substrate for doing post-translational modifications that just don't exist otherwise. And I think this is also the reason that when you do signaling, and you want to respond to the environment, you want to do most of these things. And that's why I think almost all signaling in cells happens through these post-translational modification-based enzymatic cascades. So I'm losing my voice. I could keep on talking forever. So, but that's all I basically wanted to say. I am even done. And so if you have questions, you can ask me, but I just wanted to give you a flavor of how of us, and I guess especially me, has been thinking about these kind of things, trying to make sense of the zoo of biology. And I actually think it's a string that we can pull, and we can pull it pretty hard, and there should be some principles that pop out. I'm fairly confident that this is a good string to pull. A good string to pull if you're a physicist and you want to approach these things from a physics point of view. And it connects down to engineering, which keeps you honest, I think. So anyway, thank you. Reduce variability and increase specificity. Increased specificity, I mean discriminating between things. So, and reducing variability can be just reducing the variability of a molecular motor that's stepping. Look, these things blend into each other, right? They're all in the end about, I want to create a probability current in my Markov space. I want to break time reversal symmetry. But I would say that reducing variability, there's many times you want to reduce variability that have nothing to do between telling apart two things. Right? But there's many times I want to tell apart many things. I mean, sometimes you do one to do the other, right? I mean, but I would say they're qualitatively a little bit different. One is about amplifying things beyond some delta F, and the other thing is about considering a single molecule and asking, how much noise does it have?
The kinetic insulator example in the manipulating dynamics section, right? So is it equivalent to the buffer circuit concept or something like that?
Yeah, if you're a control theorist or an electrical engineer, I encourage you to look at these papers. These are hardcore control theory papers, and they have a jargon that I have not penetrated yet, and their math seems to be more obtuse than it needs to be for my taste. But I think they're really good papers. They're hard for me to penetrate. So I know you have an engineering background, so maybe they'll make more sense to you. They do make references to bunches of things in old vacuum tube or solid state circuit, pre solid state circuits that I don't. I was born in 19 whatever. Now I'm too old to say when I was born, but I was born after vacuum circuits.
I have one more question. This may be quite naive, but just let me ask, where do the oscillators fit here, actually?
That's a great question. I think that's the manipulating dynamics.
Okay.
So UHI 2 actually has a new paper out. If you think about a limit cycle, it has to consume energy because you're breaking time reversal symmetry, right? It doesn't look the same running forward as backwards. And so UI2 has a recent paper where he does the main text I don't care for so much, but then because it's all full of biology jargon, but he has a supplementary information that has this beautiful thing with basically a Hopf oscillator. And it's really pretty. It's really pretty.
Which is that paper?
UI2 has some recent thing on thermodynamics of oscillations. I don't know what it is off the top of my head. Oh, yeah. It's UI2's group. So I feel very, I apologize in advance for not recognizing the grad student who probably did all the work. When I was a grad student, I vowed that I wouldn't remember papers by their senior authors. But here I am. There's much fewer senior authors than there are you grad students, unfortunately. So it's UI2's group. And I apologize for not knowing who the other authors are. And it just came out on the archive. I'm not even sure it's published yet. But I really enjoyed it. I really enjoyed it, and I especially enjoyed the section where they forgot about the biology and did it with a limit cycle oscillator, so I could understand what the hell was going on.
So if I want to categorize in some way the energy consumption, not to what process it related, but how in what ways it comes about, is there a way to do that? Like, as in, like, for example, you have this ATP drive which you showed in KPR and other things. Versus comparing to this XX star kind of dynamics. Is there something different?
No. Usually this XX star usually involves either phosphorylation or a GTP or something. Usually it always is. I mean, what you're doing is you're coupling it to some small molecule that the cell is maintaining out of equilibrium, right? So the energy is paid by basically actively maintaining a chemical potential of something.
So apart from ATP kind of mechanisms.
Methylation marks. They're basically any post-translational modification of a protein.
I guess what I mean is like the energy cost you showed, k log of k1 versus k2. So the other way to, like, if I'm changing my expressions levels with time,
yeah,
and I have a different, like, some of my enzyme is present, some enzyme is absent. So in those cases, is there a good way to compare cost between processes?
I don't know. But I mean, basically, if you can write your thing as a Markov process, which you always can in principle.
So it's a two Markov process which does not have the same rates.
Yeah, but you can still ask what the power of those power consumed per unit time. The power is power, right?
What I mean is like a K1 goes to zero because the enzyme is not there. So I cannot take log and compute, right? So it's two different.
It's two different Markov processes, right?
Right.
But they each have an entropy production rate which has the same units. So you can obviously compare, right? Right. I mean, you can always compare power, right? I can compare the power consumed by a Brownian motor, a molecular motor, and the power consumed by a rocket. Maybe it doesn't make sense to do that because there's just so different scales, but in principle, they have the same units, right? I can plot them on the same plot. So I can plot them. I can plot the entropy production as I change the Markov process on the same plot. So in that sense, you can compare them. Whether it makes sense to do that, I don't know. Yeah.
That requires energy.
Of course it does.
And which of these...
It doesn't fall into that.
It doesn't fall in this set, right?
I think synthesizing new things is obviously something that requires energy.
Yes.
And I just have not...
So that's not included.
No. This is all information processing.
Related, right.
Information related.
So just wanted to get a sense that in terms of the actual energy budget of the cell, how much is invested in this... In information processing, and how much is invested in actual production?
We had this conversation with Ron. I tried to go do this with Mike Springer at Harvard. I visited him one day, and we tried to do this calculation again. And we got lost in a morass for like a couple hours. But I mean, I don't know. I have no idea, but I think it is not the majority, but I don't think it's insignificant. You know, I really think it must be of order 10% of the cell's energy budget. I would say it's that order of magnitude.
So it could be evolutionarily relevant, right? The energy budget part of it. I mean, apart from the other things that it is achieving, that's a separate matter. But is the energy budget in all this, could that be of...
I don't know. I am not an evolution guy. I'm not an optimization guy. I'm much more of a what can't you do without consuming energy guy. I'm the wrong person to ask because I just don't think anything's optimized pretty much to a first approximation. Not for any good reason. It's just that's my intuition. That my intuition comes from random constraint satisfiability problems where you're never near the optimum.